So we said that we have to consider the full Penrose diagram of the black hole, and we have to impose the boundary condition. That's the two boundaries, and these will correspond to the two part of the closed time path contour. Yeah. So I'm fixing the one of the I'm fixing the transverse coordinate,
yeah,
and looking at the diagram only in terms of T and R. R is I'm just looking at T and R. So you think about that at any fixed transverse coordinate, you would have something like that. Yeah. Uh huh. Right. Constant what?
Poincaré
z.
Yeah.
The horizon,
yeah,
is at the horizon. Is at z equals z naught.
Yeah, which is not null.
Let me write it down here. So the z goes to z naught, correspond to my r star coordinates going to minus infinity. So that goes into U and V has to go to zero. Yeah, so the horizon, so write out U is equal minus E minus T minus R star 2 pi T here, and V equal this. So at fixed, if I fix V, fix for example, fix U and then follows V, so that means I'm approaching the horizon, approaching the horizon at increasing time.
So that.
Is a sphere. Here's what I don't show is the a plane.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's why. Yeah. B. Okay. Okay. So we have to. So this part. When we go from this side to this side, all U and V changes sign, and we can think about that as giving imaginary part to this T that is equal to beta over 2. 1 over pi t, 1 over 2 t, which is beta over 2. So this part corresponds to the upper part of the contour, and this boundary corresponds to the lower part of the contour. So now before, let me remind you that before drawing this diagram, we said that we can solve the wave equation on this side, and we would have in momentum space what we would obtain is is phi as a function of k and r. It could be a linear combination of two solutions that are both oscillating near the horizon, but the coefficient between them cannot be fixed completely. What we can fix from this boundary condition is that alpha k plus beta k is equal to phi 1 of k, but without knowing about how to match the solution to the other side, going through the horizon, we couldn't fix alpha and beta. So doing the analytic continuations, we now know that the solutions that continue to the right, the same solution continue to the right hand side, and it becomes, I think in my notes somehow this one is star. And then on this side, phi of k will be equal to alpha k e to the power omega over 2t f k star r plus beta of k e to minus omega over 2t phi k r. So in my convention, this one corresponds to an incoming wave, and this is the outgoing. And we, when we analytically continue, they obtain a non-trivial factor. So the boundary condition on the left side tells us that another linear combination of alpha and beta is known, namely e to omega over 2t alpha k plus e to minus omega over 2t of beta k is equal to phi 2. And so you know the full, you can solve this differential equations, and you can find the complete solution on both sides. So I will write down the solution, but anticipating that I will see thermal factor everywhere, let me introduce this notation. N actually is a function of omega, is the occupation number of the Bose-Einstein distribution function. And I will write my formulas using this N, because we will see the thermal properties of the propagators appearing more clearly in this way. So what I will find is the following, that after solving these linear equations, we find that on the right side, so on the right side, phi of k r is equal to, so n plus 1. I will skip the subscript omega minus n phi of k star time phi 1 plus square root of n plus 1 phi star k minus phi k phi 2. Okay. And there is, on the right side, the formula is also very similar. Yeah, n here I dropped the subscript omega. Here n is always omega, and k is k here is actually called k. Says both has both omega and q. The reason why there is only omega in n is that when I do the matching between the two sides, I have to look only at the near horizon region, and the equation of motion in the near horizon region contains only omega. So this is the formula that you would find. So it's similar formula for on the right hand side. Just let me just write it down. So for k phi 2 plus square root of n plus 1 k minus fk star alpha 1. So one thing you see here is that the solution on the left, on the right part, on the right quadrant depends on the boundary condition that you impose on both left and right handed side of the on both left and right right-handed boundaries. You can, for example, take the zero temperature limit and discuss what would happen in the zero at zero temperature. Let's see, at zero temperature, this n goes to zero, and so phi on the right is equal to this factor f k times phi 1. So we see that at zero temperature, in order to compute the field in the bulk, we need to know only the boundary condition on this side. We don't need to know the boundary condition on the other side. At finite temperature, the thing is that in order to find the solution on one side, you need to know the solution on both boundaries. Any question?
How to understand this purely from your condition E omega 2t, that equation is going to take the t equals to 0,
I think you can. Yeah, I think what happened is alpha would be equal to, so when t goes to zero, this factor is this is zero and this is infinite, and so alpha of k has to be, well, zero. Beta has to be equal phi 1, and alpha of k has to be phi 2 times this this factor, and then you insert into the formula, you would see that the two side decouples. Having solved the equation of motion, we just substitute this into the action. For a two-point function, we can just substitute it into the boundary action, since we know the actions of a scalar field, which is integral over rho g minus g, g mu nu, in g nu phi, g nu phi, can be reduced into integral over the boundary. And let me write down the boundary integral. So this is the formula that we have in up to a sign in at zero temperature. But now we have, so to be consistent, let me write it with R. R is some radial coordinate. Here we have two boundaries, on the left side and on the right side. So we have to take into account the two, the action will be the difference between this integral. On the right boundary, on the near the right boundary, and near the left boundary. So here I get R goes to the left, right boundary. That is the contribution from the left boundary. I think so. Yeah. So here I neglect all these contact terms in the this calculation. So I don't have any boundary term here. But in general, I think you would have to have separate boundary terms for the left and right boundaries. The coefficient between this and above here.
Yeah.
So we have alpha. We solve for alpha and beta. And then we say that on the right side, phi is equal to this. This is the thing on the right side. So you solve for alpha and beta from these two equations. Substitute here, you get this equation. And then to get the field on the left side, you have to use this. Yeah, that's how you find out the solution. Overall,
the overall sign. So
in front of the whole thing.
Right. So you have two boundaries. And
yeah.
I can see that you probably could still get a minus sign in between them.
Uh-huh.
But starting from the bulk action, how do you get
the relative? How do I get the relative minus sign between?
Not the relative, but the overall.
Yeah. Overall sign.
Yeah.
So the overall sign have to be. You have to know the overall sign here, okay, and then you. It depends on whether this radial coordinate is growing near the boundary or decreasing near the boundary. It's just reducing the some integral into the boundary integral. So there is one right sign that exists. So once you know that, you can find it.
Yes,
the relative sign. Yeah, the relative sign is a trickier question. A relative sign depends on how the relative sign. So roughly speaking, here you have if you integrate, you get the contribution on this boundary minus the contribution on this boundary. It's the integral of derivative with respect to this. Coordinates that run from here to here. You imagine that you have a coordinate that run smoothly from here to here, then you get a relative minus sign. Then you have to convert that into the coordinate you use in the on the quadrant, and then you get the minus sign, the relative minus sign. Another way to think that to know that the sign has to be minus is that if no, I'm not going to say that. Yeah, it's minus sign. Yeah.
When it takes t equals to zero, do you mean the pure ADS or the extremal value?
Either case would be correct. Yeah, this statement I made would be correct. I need temperature to go to zero. No, it comes from the orientation of the two boundary on this diagram, this minus sign that I have here. Okay, so now all the R dependence in these functions, again, as in usual case, is hidden in this mode function f sub k star. These are the solution to the mode equation to the Klein-Gordon equations written in momentum space. So we just need to put the whole thing in and then differentiate with respect to the phi 1 and phi 2. Then we would get the correlation function. So the correlation functions G would be a 2x2 matrix, because these we can differentiate with respect twice with respect to phi 1, twice with respect to phi 2, or we can compute the off-diagonal matrix element. So what I'm writing here is that schematically, what is the quadratic action, which is all that we have here. Everything is quadratic in the matrix form. So it's as a function of phi 1 and phi 2. So everything depends on k and omega, and k, which I don't write here. Okay, so now that the action is this. I will define this GA and GR in GA in a moment. Up to a numerical constant. GR is the same. I think I have I trust that you can convert from R and Z, which are opposite. Inverse of each other. Let me schematically tell you how we arrived to this equation. Again, we substitute the solution, which is written on the upper board for left and right-handed, into the boundary action. Okay. Now the what we will get here, of course, are some. Typically, we would get product. So this derivative acts only on the mode functions. So we would get different kind of the product of the mode function times its derivatives. So when after doing all these exercises with the algebra, what you'll see is that the combination that appear is f star times the radial derivatives of f. With respect to z, and all the action can be written in this matrix form, and it depends quadratically on the boundary condition.
So question is, how do you define GR and GA?
GR and GA are defined here.
I mean from.
So right now it's just the notation. You can see how they appear roughly already from this formula, because you have this f. F of k times this f times the radial derivatives. Let me try to fix the coefficient in this formula. Coefficient in front of the action integral in phi square k over 2 here. Okay.
So generally, the action is an integral over the whole space time or just one quadrant?
The action is the integral over the whole space time. We use. At zero temperature, the action becomes the sum of the two contributions. This way of doing things, the action at the end turn out to be the sum of the two boundary terms on the two boundaries. But the derivative of the field near one boundary depends on the both boundary values of the field. There is a decoupling that is at zero temperature, the action becomes the difference between the action on the left and the action on the right. And
you
then.
Or is this work directly at zero temperature?
You can do that in Euclidean space.
Yeah.
In real time, if you do it the same way as we did here, if you take the zero temperature limit, what you see is that you have two separate copies of quantum field theories. In one copy, you have your the usual copy, and another copy is where time is going backward, roughly speaking. So if you do calculation of correlation function, you don't have to think about the other copy at all. You just differentiate the action with respect to the boundary condition in this that copy. You are blind to what's happening on in the other copy of space-time. Yeah. So in this sense, the zero temperature limit reduces to the usual way of doing things with just one boundary. Whatever you put on the other boundary doesn't affect the G11 correlator that you compute. Yeah.
One of the boundary to calculate the correlation functions.
Yeah.
Only if I think of an energy continuation from the non-zero T to zero T by that point, then just a peak just right hand phi R over just think of.
Let's do zero temperature. So zero temperature, all this N goes away. So T goes to zero, it becomes F of K, phi 1. That's it.
Yeah. You say that, those two boundaries are decomposed.
Yeah, so the solution in this right quadrant depends only on the boundary condition.
So we
on
the don't think about the phi S
over there. You can just say from the action, you know, that matrix in zero, the zero temperature, the off diagonal term just be zero.
Yes, the same thing happened at the matrix. Let me finish that one. And if you see at the level of the metric also, that is a very apparent. N goes to zero. So you have this, the action depends. The action is the sum of the two actions. It's diagonal.
I see.
Yeah.
So can I, so this is a general feature that, for example, off diagonal terms G11, G12, and G21, they're real. So because
So it's, you can see that it has to be equal because you just compute the same thing.
I'm talking about real or imaginary. So it's real and it's a general feature or it's not?
Well, staring at this expression, you can see it has to be imaginary. For the same, if you compute two-point function of the same field, the same real field, that is, that you can show that it has to be purely imaginary. But I don't, right away I don't know how to show it from holography, but as you define the, if you look at quantum field theory definition of the correlator, you see that it is in the spectral you have a spectral representation where you can see it's completely imaginary, that two-point function. It's I times the expectation value of the product of operators. Okay, so.
Through the field theory, can I see this as coupling to different CFTs? From the field theory perspective.
Okay, so here the claim is that if I do these calculations, I will find the thermal correlation function in one CFT. So this one CFT put at finite temperature, and the correlation function that we find here is this real-time correlation function for one CFT at finite temperature.
So can it be just a copy of the same CFT?
There is a Hamiltonian formulation
of this,
expectation values in that entangled state of things.
So, yeah. Okay. So, we use the this correlation function, which is a 2x2 matrix now. And we remember that for the linear response theory, we usually need to look at the retarded Green's function. Okay, the retarded Green's function, let's recall. Retarded correlator is equal to, we can write it as G11 minus, I think, in this case, e to minus omega over 2t G12 at sigma equal beta over 2. So if you look at these 2 and then subtract 1 from the other, this is G11. In the way I'm doing that, I think this one is actually minus G12. In the convention that I'm using, so it's actually equal to the the quantity that we have introduced here as GR. GR is simply the retarded propagator, and I have chosen the notation there so that it is the retarded correlator. So here is what happened. If we need to, at the end, what we find is that if we want to compute the retarded two-point function, we can just look at the incoming. Solve the wave equations and get the solution that correspond to an incoming wave, and then proceed in a very naive way with the ADS-CFT prescription. And then we will get from this formula, which is the generalization of the same formula at zero temperature. But now we will get the retarded Green's function.
So in that case, you can solve the equation for F just in one of the coordinates, but R is
defined. Well, F is defined, F is always defined. You can compute the function F in one corner. Yeah, effectively here I already, when I wrote down this set of equations here, I'm already go back to the Poincaré coordinate, but with two separate coordinate system and the two psi. Yeah, but the same function appear there. If you compute loop, or so here we have a black hole in ADS space, so it's you can think about so you can your question again, how do you compute if you compute the one loop graph, do you see Hawking radiation?
Is that maybe one loop? May I just take some Hawking radiation? Argument to make some corrections to your way to formalize the your real-time calculations, and will this gives the 101 corrections or maybe even the high-order corrections? Because you treat the horizon absorb all the incoming waves completely, so this is the classical black hole in some sense, right?
Well. To the leading order, this is this result. This thing in 1/n, you can always do a classical calculation as you do. If you want to do a loop calculation, I suspect you would have to compute some kind of diagrams where this you have a loop but the internal point of the loop can be either here or here. or it can be on both sides, or it can be one here and one here, and then come back. So it will be, in some sense, you might have you will need to the full the full 2x2 correlation function to compute that. I'm not sure if I understand your question. I don't understand. Yeah. Go. Any other question? Not to say that I have done any loop calculation here, but this is the way that I imagine a loop calculation can be done. Yeah, both sides show up. Yeah, people I think have been trying to do that. It's loop calculation. Okay, so let me now use this formula, which we obtained from the generalization of the ADS-CFT prescription to finite temperature in real time, and compute the shear viscosity of, say, N equal 4 super young Mills plasma. So let us recall the Kubo's formula. Kubo formula tells us that in order to find the viscosity, we have to take it's equal to limit 1 over omega imaginary part of the TXY correlator at omega, say, let's put Q equals 0 here, and then take omega to 0. Low frequency part of this retarded Green function. Since we are looking at the retarded Green function, we will be using that formula over there. Okay, so here we have to expand the action to quadratic order, expand the Einstein's action to quadratic order. So you have this action. So in five dimension, you have some volume of five sphere that come from the S5 divided by the Einstein constant in 10 dimension. Integral over d5x rho g of r, so very roughly you can write this action, and then you perturb the metric g mu nu equal g mu nu 0 plus h mu nu. But in our case, we want to perturb, this is the will be the black hole metric, this is the correction, but we want to turn on simple h x y, one component of the perturbation of the metric tensor, and then expand to second order. So when we do that, what we will find is that the action actually has the same form as the action for a minimally coupled scalar. Minus g minus g mu nu d mu phi, where that phi is equal to g naught mu nu h if you raise one index of the HXY, then you get the scalar field that appear in the action. So the equation of motion for a tensor fluctuation is the same as the equation of motion for a minimally coupled scalar. That actually, if you look at the any textbook which discuss the cosmological perturbation, that is one fact that they mentioned there. That's the tensor metric perturbation satisfies the same equation as a minimally coupled scalar. So all this calculation that we did here actually transfers very well into the calculations of the operator dual to a scalar. Here, this phi can be thought of as an operator that coupled to Txy. So if we insert the metric, let me do it here. It will be, there is a coefficient in front for kappa n square times with the integral over dz before x. R cube, z cube. And then we will have F is e phi square minus dt phi square over F plus di phi square. Since we are going to work with zero q, this part is never going to matter. The only dependence of the function phi is on time and on the radial z coordinate. So this I insert here to this action the black hole metric. Okay, so now what we have to do is we have to find this mode function f sub k. Okay, so there are probably too many f's here. The f here is 1 minus z to the 4, the factor in the metric. And the sub f sub k is the solution to the mode equation. So in order to avoid this the 2f, let me call this f sub k phi. Okay, and solve the equation for the scalar field. Okay, the equation looks like this, the equation of motion. It's going to be, let me see, I'm not sure. This one doesn't go up, so I have to be careful with space here. F divided by z cube, phi prime prime. In momentum space, now I have plus omega square over z cube, F of phi equals 0. A prime denote a differentiation with respect to the radial coordinate z. Okay. So with the boundary condition we impose on this phi, we call that this phi is actually we denote this f sub k, so that we would not have to deal with two different function f here. This phi at z equals 0 has to be equal 1, and its incoming wave at z equals z0. Well, incoming wave, what does it mean, incoming wave? Incoming wave means that it has to be proportional to e to the power of I. So this the wave has to be e to minus I omega t plus r star. So that was, so this phi has to be proportional to e omega I omega r star. Okay, r star is this torus coordinate that we introduced previously. You can actually any questions so far before I proceed?
So basically you just do the same thing with previous scalar field case.
Yeah, this is now the our goal is to compute this retarded gain functions, so we need the solution to the wave equations. That is incoming wave and his boundary condition equal to 1 at the boundary. So that's the equation that we have to solve. this equation is cannot be solved exactly. But it can be solved approximately at small omega, and that's what I'm going to describe. How it looks like. First, I have to just draw a picture of how does the solution look like at small omega, and then we will see that without much calculations, we can find the retarded Green's function. So here is what I'm going to draw, f of z as a function of z. And since f, since phi is going to be a complex solution due to this incoming wave boundary condition, I will be able to draw only the real part. There is also the imaginary part that is off phase. So the boundary condition is that at z equals 0, this function is 1. Now, if omega is equal to 0, you can see that actually there is a very good solution, phi equal to 1. Phi equal to 1 is a good solution at 0 omega. At finite omega, actually, what happened is that this phi remains constant for a long time, and then it will start oscillating as we go very close to this point. It oscillates like this exponent tells us to oscillate. As you recall, that this tortoise coordinate r star goes to minus infinity. So there is an infinite number of oscillation here at omega t I plus minus I omega r star. Yeah. So that is roughly how the solution looks like. You have to you have to do a perturbation theory to be to see that rigorously. You have to do a perturbation theory with respect to this omega. But this will be the result that you get. And it's natural, right? This in the outside region where f is still where omega the omega term is still negligible, I have a simplest solution, phi equal to 1. And then as I approach the horizon, this smallness of omega is compensated by the smallness of this function f. So I start to see this oscillation with frequency omega. Any question? Okay, so now we have to find out this the derivative of the function. But there is a very interesting thing that we can notice, that this equation implies the conservation of flux. A flux that I will determine here. The flux is phi star dz phi time r cube divided by z cube. My claim is that the derivative of this one with respect to z is equal to 0. Basically, you say that this equation has two solutions. One solution and its complex conjugate, and you construct the Wronskian of that between these two solutions, and the Wronskian is constant as a function of z, and this is just the Wronskian that I have computed. So the same, if you think about that as an equation of quantum mechanics, that is just the conservation of the flux. There is an f. Thank you. Yeah, there is an f. There's an f here. Yes, that F comes from this one. Yeah. Okay, so that means that this thing that appears in the retarded screen functions is nothing but the flux at can be thought of as the flux at z equals 0. And instead of computing the flux at z equals 0, you can compute the flux, for example, in the regime where this function is oscillating. Okay. So recall that. So now we can use this to compute the flux at z close to z zero, and here it is useful to go to the coordinates that I call r star. So it is equal to f times phi star d over d r star phi. You can check the definition of this coordinate on r star that I have introduced previously. But this one, if you look at the dependence of phi with respect to r star, its derivative brings down one factor of omega. It is f times, this f is not here, it is in the definition of r star, so it's equal to the basically phi square times omega, I omega. So what we did here, we say that the retarded Green function can be related to a flux, and then we look at how the flux is conserved, and so the flux can be computed in the regime when the flux is when the function is oscillating. And when it's oscillating, the derivative around the radial direction is just a time derivative. It's a plane wave. Plane wave in the coordinate t and r star. So the flux is just the frequency time the amplitude. The amplitude square is the thing that I cannot explain to you rigorously. But looking at this picture, what would happen? What happened is that at small omega much less than t, the amplitude of this oscillation near the horizon is still equal to 1. You see that the if you solve the equation, that is what would happen. I actually thought about a way to derive that fact without doing the perturbation theory of omega, but I didn't find it. So you have to accept that this one goes to 1. At small omega, the amplitude of its oscillations is still 1. So the flux is equal to I omega. And the correlation function can now be read from this expression that is right there. What would happen is that this one will be equal to, so you have to figure out this, you have to have this factor. This is V5 over 2 kappa 10 square times R cubed, that will always be there. And then you will find, I think that's it. I think if you be careful with all the coefficients, which I think I'm careful with them now, minus I omega. That's what you get for the retarded screen function. Yes? Yeah, you multiply this equation by phi star. Yeah, and then you take you subtract the Hermitian conjugate, and then you get this. Okay. Good. We found the resultant screen functions, which is related to the shear viscosity. The viscosity will be the limit of this function when omega goes to zero divided by omega, so the shear viscosity is something like five-dimensional divided time r cubed to kappa 10 squared, which I leave the parameters as in the gravitational side. You can actually translate them into the formula in the in the gauge theory side. Somehow, I think I missed this factor of z to the cube here, z zero cube. Okay, where is it coming from? That's actually it is here. So it is a z cube, zero cube here. Okay. Does that come from the expression of the flux contain this z, and near the horizon that z is becomes z naught cube. Okay. So now let's compare that to the entropy density. So the entropy per unit three volumes of this black brain solution, whose metric is contain this r square over c square dx square plus part that r square over z square minus dt square plus dx square f here, z square f here. Now the volume, the entropy is just the area of the horizon divided by 4 times the Newton's constant, and this Newton's constant, this kappa 10 that I introduce here, is just 8 pi g. So you see that all these factors, they actually appear in the area of the horizon. There is a volume of the sphere, r cubed over z naught cubed, that can trace back into this this metric on the horizon. And then there is a factor of 4g, which turn out at the end. It comes that I have kappa naught 10 squared here in the 2 pi. So this is the entropy per unit volume. This is entropy density, this entropy in 3 volume. The black brain is translationally symmetric. I didn't take into account another factor in the area of the horizon, just proportional to the horizon. So z naught coming here in conjunction with r square here, they have a three-dimensional space with the metric equal to r square over z square. So you take the root of the determinant of this 3 by 3 metric, and that gives you r naught cubed divided by z naught cubed here. In the entropy, you asked about?
Yeah.
In the entropy, it appears it's from the metric on the... I don't know how to think about entropy as counting degrees of freedom this way. I just take the semi-classical result. Yeah. So I don't have to think about that. But in principle, that in the from ADS-CFT correspondence, we now understand this is the degrees of freedom, number of degrees of freedom in the thermal plasma. So comparing these two results, you find this eta over s for this is equal 1 over 4 pi. You actually don't have to translate the result to the field theory parameters.
Sorry, the entropy of the plasma in this 2 unit volume is t cubed?
It's t cubed, yeah.
But
times
the number, here z naught is equal to 0. So
z naught is not a 0. Z naught is the So Z naught is proportional to the radius to the temperature. I'm sorry, Z naught is like one over temperature. Yeah. So it's you see a T cube dependence here. Yeah. And you translate this one will have n, and you'll see this n squared coming out from this factor.
I'm afraid that the conservation of the flux should be the conservation of the imaginary part of the flux.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, that you are right. That's, I wasn't careful here. The imaginary part of this one. Yeah. Yeah. You're right. Thank you for that. Okay, so and we need the imaginary part of the 3,000 screen function, so we just compute, you can compute the imaginary part this way, and we find, and actually you can see the all this calculation is very insensitive to the precise form of the metric, for example. So this relationship is hold within a class of the theory where this step can be done. So one is that and the equation of motion for the tensor fluctuation has to reduce to a equation for a scalar. That requires for a minimally coupled scalar. That requires Einstein's gravity. So in all theories with Einstein gravity dual, this ratio is equal to 1 over 4 pi. There is a very interesting connection, which has not been, at least to me, explained in a satisfactory way. In black hole physics, people talk about the notion of the viscosity at the horizon, and there is a universal value of the viscosity at the horizon, which can be defined rather formally. And the ratio of eta west at the horizon is equal to 1 over 4 pi. So seems to be a connection between this fact and the fact from the physics of the horizon, usually called the membrane paradigm in black hole physics. So Hong Liu and you did some work where you show that you can actually write down a formula that relates the viscosity with some quantity, basically the gravitational constant for transverse graviton at the horizon, right? So that you can actually do. You actually don't have to go through all the steps. Just look at the gravitational action, and you get the viscosity. Now this correction, you have this correction, which depends on the sign, whose magnitude will be proportional to the coefficient in front of this R square, and this has been computed. Two derivative term, you mean? What is two derivative? R is two derivative.
All possible high derivative terms?
No, it's just for a particular set of high derivative term. You go to R square. I think there is one linear combination of different structures that you can write down for the action, and that you can find the correction. Yeah, I can tell you later, because it's a rather long story. I'm making this comment for people who heard about this membrane paradigm. Yeah.
So this I heard recently that I guess maybe Walla or some other people show that if you just look at the near horizon equation of motion for a black hole, you get the Navier-Stokes equation.
Uh-huh.
So is there some way in that language that you can
You see this happening?
Yeah.
Not directly here. So the way that I restrict my treatment here is, first of all, it's a linear analysis, and secondly, I look at the channel in the correlation function which has no pole. So this TXY correlation function has no hydrodynamic pole. You don't excite hydrodynamic mode. I hope Shiraz will be talking about that here. I hope, yeah. And I can comment a little bit about that later.
But,
yeah.
But I think if one uses the conservation of the flux, he can express the viscosity in terms of the metric near the horizon. I mean, by just taking the conservation, because you can invent not only at the boundary, but also at the
Yes, that's what I was trying to say. You need to know also the effective gravitational coupling at the horizon in general. Here in the Einstein gravity, there is just one value. Okay, so I have some minutes left, I think. I will just switch the topic completely and talk about the theory in that whose experimental realization is done in various places in the world, including at Chile. That is the so-called unitarity fermions. Okay. So I will postpone the discussion of the issues related to gauge gravity duality and hydrodynamics to the end of the last and the next lecture. Which just motivate what I'm going to talk about in the next lecture. So we see that there is, in some sense, right now the N equal 4 super young Mill theory or theories in the class, strongly coupled theory that have gravity dual are considered as some kind of simplest model of a strongly coupled quark gluon plasma. There is a non-relativistic counterpart of the strongly coupled quark gluon plasma that is called unitarity fermions. And I have to explain to you this what unitarity means. So fermions you already know. Non-relativistic, you already know, but we have to. I want to explain to you this notion of unit of fermions at unitarity. Now switch back to non-relativistic quantum mechanics. So you have to think about a physics where if you have one particle, that's one particle. You never get particle hole creation. Consider the system of two particles in quantum mechanics. So let's go back to very simple quantum mechanics with a centrally symmetric potential. And for simplicity, I will just take the square well potential. So you imagine two particles interacting with some potential that depends on R. And this is the potential, simplest potential I will draw here. What I know about this, and if you have taken quantum mechanics, you remember, if the potential is shallow, there is no bound state. If the potential is sufficiently deep, you will have a bound state or a series of bound states. Depending on how deep the potential is, you will have a series of bound states. Right? Now, the regime that we are interested in is the following regime. I will fine-tune the depth of the potential so that there is one bound state with zero energy. That requires a V naught here minus the depth of the potential is minus V naught, where V naught is of order 1 over m R naught square, where R naught is this radius of the square well potential. There should not be any question right now, right? If there is question, then I'm in trouble. Okay, so the next thing we want to do is to shrink the size of the potential to zero. And then make the, but at the same time, keeping the bound state. So that requires R naught going to zero, minus V naught going to infinity, but V naught times R naught square is equal to some fine-tuned value. Finely tuned value of order one that we can in principle figure it out very easily, but I will not do it here. So what happened here is that you can think about this in a simplistic way. This way, those simplistic because in sometimes people are more used to quantum field theory compared to quantum mechanics. So this quantum mechanics might picture might be a little bit complicated. If this is complicated for you, I just write down the action of a quantum field theory. That would do the same thing. So it's three-dimensional action minus square over 2m. So this is the kinetic term of non-relativistic particles. And then I would add to that a potential term. So we shrink the potential to zero. That means we are looking at point-like interactions. We look at point-like interactions, and then this is the point-like interaction. But when we write in the theory in this way, you have to be careful what do you call C naught. Okay. So naively, C naught would be equal to the integral over the whole space of the potential. If the potential is a delta function, this integral would give you the coefficient in front of the delta function. However, if you look at this procedure that we are doing here, the integral gives you the factor of R naught cube, and that is have to be 1 over R naught square in order for the this bound state to have zero energy. So in fact, this C naught is a constant that goes to zero as we take R naught going to zero. So here, what happened in the quantum field theory language? What happened here is that we have to think about this as a theory with some cutoff lambda. Okay? And then we fine-tune this coefficient C naught that is of order 1 over lambda to reach a critical point. And we will discuss that critical point next time and look at that critical point from various perspectives. The way that it's non-trivial to see is that if you do a naive dimensional counting, this for Fermi interaction is irrelevant in three dimensions. In three dimensions, if you do the following dimensional counting, where space is counted as dimension minus one and time as dimension minus two, so that this time derivative and grad square have the same dimension, then the dimension of psi would be equal 3/2, which is very easy to see from the kinetic term, and the dimension of C naught is equal minus one. So minus one means that we have a irrelevant perturbation. The fact that we can achieve a fine-tuned fixed point by dialing these coefficients means that in the beta function for this coefficient there is a non-trivial UV fixed point that we will talk about next time. Okay, so I ran out of time. We will discuss the symmetry of this theory next time.